What's up? It is your girl Kelly. I am back with you guys here once again. Thank you so much for clicking on this video, and I appreciate you so much for being here. And I ask only that you hit that subscribe button, guys. Please join my channel and help me to reach my goal. I'm trying to reach 100 subs by the end of January, and I believe with you guys' help, if everyone who watches video would just hit that subscribe button, y'all would make my dream come true. So please help me and do that, guys. If you're not new here, if you're returning, if you have been watching and enjoying the content, then you guys already know y'all are the best, and I appreciate you guys as always. So I wanted to come on here and provide an update, guys, because there has been a lot coming out, okay, about these Idaho murders, guys, and I think we all are aware of what's going on. This case has really wrapped a lot of people up in it, myself included. You know, every now and then, you know, I talked about the Casey Anthony case, I've talked about, like, the JaMonae Ramsey case. There are others, you know, too, that I haven't talked about yet, but this is, like, you know, every now and then, you just get kind of invested into, if you're into true crime, that is, you know, you get kind of invested into certain things that happen. And especially with crimes such as those, you know, where it's unexpected. Like, it's something that you don't see a lot of. And it just kind of wakes you up and wakes you up to the reality of the world and the world that we're living in. It's like that, you know, a terrible thing could happen totally outside of your control and out of the blue. And you know, it's not, you can't really feel safe anywhere, including in your own home at your college campus. So there has just been a firestorm of things like coming out recently. So I wanted to get up on here. I actually was trying to, I made this whole video yesterday. And then after I made it, I set it to like premiere this morning, and I had to go back and change it because so much more came out even since I did it and recorded it last night. And so I'm trying to, and I'm working on being, I'm working on trying to, like, not talk so much and, like, give so much, but it's, like, sometimes I just get wrapped up, guys. I really do. I get just long-winded with my thoughts, and I include maybe too much in these videos that I don't need to include, but, you know, I'm working on it. So we're going to try to, throw some more items into this video, but I'm going to try to condense things to make it more precise and to the point, and still try to include everything that it is that I want to include that I think is important and that I think is interesting. So without further ado, guys, please hit that like button. Please leave me a comment. Let me know what y'all think about the video. And I appreciate your honest feedback, as always. And let's get into it, guys. So I want to start off with a couple videos. There was a development about a white vehicle. Okay, so the police came out and, you know, basically told the public that they were looking for this white Hyundai Elantra. So let's get into a news article, or not, I guess it's from Inside Edition, so it's not an article, but it's like a news video, I guess you could say, about this white vehicle, and we'll get into it from there. Okay, guys, so let me get that set up and we'll get that played. Okay, so here we go.
Andrew, good evening. Good to see you. Well, about an hour and a half ago, Fox News Digital reporting that detectives have obtained 8 hours of security footage from a gas station here in Moscow. And the biggest thing to take out of that is that they saw a white sedan passing by the gas station early in the morning, the night of those four murders. And that's relevant because over the last few days, police have been asking the public's help for any information on a white 2011 to 2013 Hyundai Elantra. That car was spotted near the scene of the crime on the night of those four murders. Police believe that whoever was in that Elantra could have critical information related to this case. And the Moscow Police Department has been combing through hours of surveillance footage. Hasn't resulted in any leads yet, but police are saying that even though they don't have a suspect, tips are coming into the department, and this is not a cold case.
Well, this investigation is not cold. We get dozens and dozens of tips. We sort through them, we prioritize them, and for sure, some of them are not good tips. They're not even relevant to the case. But every single day, we get a good amount of viable tips.
Andrew, the county coroner here, told Fox News that investigators put paper bags over the victim's hands at the scene to preserve DNA evidence. Forensics experts say the victims could have the killer's hair or skin on their hands underneath their fingernails if they touched the killer trying to defend themselves. Andrew?
And so that's a very interesting piece of information that came out as well, the bags over the hands. So it's you can only hope that they will be able to retrieve some sort of DNA, especially since it's already been confirmed that at least one or two of the roommates fought back. So you would have to assume that there would be something here that they would be able to find as it relates to DNA. And so the white car, you know, they put out that statement and said that there was, you know, they wanted to speak to whoever was in that white car because they were able to pinpoint a white vehicle in the area at the time of the murders, which they're saying is from between 3 and 4. And there was a lot going on at that time. I mean, it was like already, you know, it's a college campus, so you have a bunch of people that are all over the place at all times, young kids. It's not odd to see a bunch of them out late at night around that time. So you have a lot of factors already, guys. And so the police have their work cut out for them. I mean, they really, really do. And so we will see if they're going to be able to actually make something come of this. But apparently there's been a lot of tips flooding in, and it's going to be harder and harder if they don't get something nailed down sooner rather than later. So the next video I want to show you guys is going to be from this YouTube channel, and it's a long video. This is what kind of like took up a lot of my time yesterday, but I'm gonna put it at like 2 times the speed, so the voices are gonna sound like, you know, sped up, but this will help us get through it because the video was so interesting. And I would definitely recommend you guys you know, check out the link. I'm gonna put it in the description box and watch the video on your own time and see what you can gather from it, because I found it to be really good information. The guy who was narrating the video, he was an ex-detective, and so he gave really good insight, I thought. And I've been watching his videos since then because I find him to be pretty credible. And I found out about this guy from watching Nancy Grace's podcast. So that is just a little background, and we're going to get right into his video right now. So let me go and cue him up. Oh, no, that's not him. That is, let's see. Where did I put him? He's over here. Okay. All right, y'all ready? Here we go.
No, between campus and off campus.
So we're coming over the hill here, and this is when you're actually...
Okay, so this is basically, this is going to help us get a better understanding, because me personally, only seeing what the media had shown us up until this point, before I watched this video, I had no really idea of what the layout of the different buildings and the different areas that we were talking about. So like, I knew that the frat house and the girl's house was close. I didn't know exactly how close. And so I knew that the girls lived up on a hill, but I had no idea what was all around them in relation to their house. But this really breaks it down. He actually drove to the location to give this guided tour, and so I found it to be very helpful, and it helped me kind of put my thoughts together on what it is made everything make more sense. And so like some of these theories that we're going to get into a little bit later on, it helps to know exactly what it is we're talking about and where things actually are, because then you can know and you can understand who exactly could have done this and who you can kind of rule out based on proximity and all these other things. So this is, he's going to get into it right now. And so I'm going to try to kind of skip through and just hit all the good points. So
really going to see the university on the right. So this is off-campus housing. This is not on the campus of Idaho State. So let's always remember that as well. So here you can see, there's the sign. All right, now we're going to start moving into what I would consider a geographical importance for this particular crime. And the reason I say that, as you can see, you know, if it's a total off the 95 and into this neighborhood, it's not like someplace that just shows up. Or to the right is the fraternity house, and then to the left, right? Yeah. That, go ahead.
1, join Weight Watchers.
2, take the quiz.
3,
ma'am, no ma'am, no ma'am.
Go ahead.
Let me point this out on the right. So you see that blue, it's the Sigma Chi fraternity house. You can see that big green space, open field, it's their backyard. And so now you're, obviously we're looking at Taylor
right
Street right here, and you're
going to
see how close the girls' apartment
house,
or, house was to this.
Yeah, and it's University of Idaho, not Idaho State. Thank you, Sergio, for catching my error on that. So I apologize to Idaho State. sorry about that, guys. All right, here we go.
They're fine.
So these are all houses around the main 1122. All this is the streets where the Uber would have turned, or the friend who drove them home. It's a friend, apparently, and they've not released that individual's name. But this is the area. And you're going to see this kind of goes up and it dead ends. Okay? That's important to understand. There's the house.
Right,
at
right
about
here.
1 o'clock.
Behind this one.
The house is about 2 o'clock now. It's on the right.
Right here.
I'm going to take you up to this apartment complex here.
Okay.
On the other side.
So as he said, you know, there it dead ends right here. So once you turn onto this little area, and I want to show you guys, we're going to zoom out really quickly because I pulled it up on, you know, I didn't realize there was a thing called Google Earth. You know, I obviously could have done that a long time ago, but, you know, just brain fart moment, woman moment, you know. But let's zoom out a little bit so we can understand, okay? This is the house, okay, right? So he would have been turning, like he's traveling down this road here, right? And so the frat house, they just passed it up and they would have turned right here onto what I believe is King Street, or no, Taylor. And so then he would have turned onto King, which would have been right here. And this is the dead end area, which I think, like, if, let me see, this whole thing is kind of a dead end. Like, you see how it's just kind of like a big circle here? So if you turn into here, you're gonna hit the back end of these apartments, and you can't really get out right there with your vehicle. On foot, obviously you can, but this whole thing is just kind of like a dead end. So that's what he was trying to explain, was that once you turn right here by the frat house, you have to go down this little side street, and then you come down this street. There's two houses right here, and then their house, and this is their like little parking area. And so now he is driving right past and he's going to turn around. So I'm going to fast forward a little bit, and then we're going to get into the actually the setup of the house, and they're going to walk all around it and give us better angles of what it is that we're looking at here. So let me fast forward just a bit. Okay, so now you guys can see they're kind of at the back, or they're walking towards the back of the house
rear
now.
And to the side, around to the front. Because you'll notice that tape, and we're going to go a little bit closer to that when we get to the back. But that was the first thing that caught my attention walking up this hill. You see the tape there clearly?
How, like,
it's around the front.
It sits on a hill.
And then you have this other tape on the other side. So somebody either pulled it around the front as a narrow crime scene, and then they later expanded it, or are they looking for physical evidence around that part of the building? We'll talk a little bit deeper about this in a little bit. I have a lot of thoughts on this one. Karen, any thoughts?
If you're just joining us, this is the back view of the home. That's the deck that'd be the third floor, and then below it would be the second floor. And we're going to give you a better perspective here, you'll see. But again, we wanted to show the back of this home. It's woodsy. There it is steep. Where the silver car is parked, that is typically filled with student parking, students' cars. But you've got a fair amount of woods, trees back there.
And I talked to the owner of this car right there, and he told me that he backs it in purposely because it gets so icy in that area back there, that he pointed out some of the other cars, and you'll see it here in a couple seconds, that other students pull in, but they have a heck of a time trying.
And it's interesting, guys, because if you notice,
like everybody else around there, a lot
of them
woke up to the
commotion
taking place.
Back around the side of
the house. Deeper-
and again, let's zoom right out again, because this I found to be helpful. You know, this is their house here, so all these trees and everything here, there's nothing else behind their house besides that parking lot. And there's another house way back here, right? But other than that, it's mainly just trees. And so they have a big gap right here where, you know, somebody could easily be hanging out and, you know, sneaking around in these trees. And it's dark back here when it's late at night, which is when they were attacked, you know, very late at night. I mean, easily somebody could have been hanging out in this area for a long time in their car waiting for them to get home. Or another theory was that the guy had actually waited, like, late in wait whenever he saw that everyone had left the house, he then let himself in and waited for them to get back, which is honestly terrifying. I mean, I can't imagine any of this to begin with, but like, I don't know what's worse, honestly, like somebody breaking in or the idea of somebody just waiting for you in your house, in your bedroom. I mean, it's both awful. We have to understand the severity of this incident and this crime, this horrible homicide that took place, and just pray for these people that were involved, because it truly is one of the worst things ever. So, okay, let's go back, and then he's going to take us back around. There's a few more interesting things that I found in his video that I wanted to make sure that we touched on. Okay, not that one. We got a lot to get into, guys, so let's play it from here.
Dive here in a couple minutes, because I think this is about a suspectology. What type of individual would take such a high risk unless...
Oh, did I mess you up there, guy? What did I do? Is it loading?
For an individual to commit such a high-profile situation and then flee up this area, you know, I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm saying I don't know if it's probable, no.
Okay.
The point of entry, this would be very easy to get into this residence.
So.
Underneath that window. And then, while everybody's been looking at the
pointed this out, okay,
screen as a potential, you know, removed point of entrance, take a look at that cinder block. And then we have to think about, okay, why is that there? Not how did it get there? From a behavioral analysis aspect, why is it there? Is it part of the barbecue set? Is it, you know, what's going on? There's a step upon a step, a seat, okay? But.
And me personally, I don't put too much stock into this back situation right here. I think it's possible that whoever did this could have let themselves in through one of these windows. More than likely, no. My theory is kind of now, like, honestly, that I think that he might have even gone through the front door, whoever did this. And it's less likely that he went in through the sliding glass door. But that theory also makes sense if it's somebody that was familiar with the house and felt comfortable coming into this house, because they did, you know, come and go often. So it's a few people that are in the mix now that people are really starting to have questions about and are really starting to have a lot of chatter about. And we'll get into those, in a second. But I just want to point that out, that he put a lot of stock into, like, this situation, the screen being on the ground, the cinder block. I don't really find too much credence in that. But at this point, who knows, guys? Anything's possible. We're learning that with this crime scene and with this investigation, anything is possible, literally. So let's move on, okay? Again, he's on the side here. This is their balcony at the top, the girls. And this is still the side view of the house.
Yeah, I mean, let's look through the eyes of the perpetrator. What's this individual doing? Has he scoped this out multiple times? What's he looking for? You can clearly see into this house. They were very social. All of the girls. Now that window potentially could come in play. And then you put the block underneath the other window. Is this suspect, you know, is he out surveilling this house on numerous occasions? And that's just kind of, you know, something that doesn't look out of the ordinary.
And he said a couple days after the murders, they got that light is now working. And he said it illuminates the whole area at night. It comes on at dark.
But if you'll notice underneath that, those, the authorities, by left.
So apparently he found a glove.
Remember, I'm from Southern California, and we know the value of gloves.
While they were out on the scene, and the cops hadn't seen it yet, I think it
right. And it's definitely worth pointing out that we don't know how long it's been there. Obviously, don't know who.
I think it's more than likely that the glove belonged to one of the police officers that maybe just dropped it on accident as they were trying to dispose of it. It is very sloppy. It's very bad. It's a very bad look for the police if they dropped a glove and then just didn't notice, then someone else who was there doing investigative journalism had to point this out to them, which is what ended up happening. So he does talk about this for a little while. That's interesting, but I just don't want to waste much time on that. So, okay, now this part is the interesting bit that I was kind of new to me. So let's start it from right about here.
Memorial items that were left for Ethan, Zanna, Kaylee, and Madison.
People stop
by,
put
things down there.
Okay, another observation. Honey, what are your thoughts on this?
So let's show it to them before we explain it, because you have to see it first.
Okay. And also, the other thing about the glove, hypothetically. What if it was taken from the house and the suspect
So guys, they're about to get into...
I'm hearing slow down the chat. All right, so give me 30 seconds.
Okay.
Let me do that real
y'all
fast.
See this sidewalk right
here? You got the shovel.
Okay, so what you're going to be seeing here on the video is a different perspective, a different approach that one could take coming to the house. And you're going to see I'm just going to tell you the highlight of it, what it is. So basically, if somebody came from Taylor Street, if you remember, that's over where the Sigma Chi Fraternity house is, that big open green space area,
this
and big field. And then you've got Taylor Avenue or Taylor Street. And we walked it, we thought this was really interesting. It's a direct line uphill. There's a concrete path and steps that would lead you right to the house. So if somebody was to, let's say, come in from Taylor, and by the way, the 95,
this is Taylor.
Remember that part of earlier in the video, we made that left turn and we got on Taylor. So if you came in off the 95, turned on Taylor, came down, there is parking spaces. One could walk from Taylor Street all the way up to the front of the house at 1122 King Street or King Road. And you'll see that perspective. We thought it was interesting enough to point it out.
Yep. And Mods, I've just slowed it down. So thank you for bringing it to my attention. And thank you, everybody, for being so classy in this chat for these victims here. That's what it's about. So this is an interesting perspective here.
This is what led me to believe that the front door.
So what we did is we walked from
very
Taylor Street. Okay, obviously there's the fraternity house. We know that's where Ethan and Santa were that night. And this is Taylor Street, where this blue dumpster is. And you can literally walk up here. And what I noticed, what we both noticed, we looked at the eaves of these houses right there. No security cameras, no outdoor lighting that was visible. No motion lights, and no any other kind of fixed outdoor lights. Now, that being said, they could have been on the front of these homes that you're seeing on the right. But what we're saying is this path would have been extremely dark that night. And it's a direct path right up into the front of the house.
So understand. Also understand to dovetail on what Karen's saying, that all behavior has a purpose. All behavior has a purpose. So if this individual had parked out there, he or she has, it's going to be a he, he's got a direct path right to the front door of where these victims are. And the only other block that I saw in this entire area was right there to the right. As you pass this house, you see that double cinder block there? It's being...
And so it's interesting theory, because this kind of puts more stock into it being someone that either was more of a stranger that was familiar with the layout of the house, but maybe didn't live in the immediate area. Okay, so I'm so torn about this, guys, because there's a few, and we're gonna get into each one of them. There's actually a few, I wouldn't call them suspects, but just a few people that, like, I think that could be potentials, right? That literally live within, like, a walking distance. And when I say walking distance, I mean, like, within that little cul-de-sac, that little area, either in the frat house, in one of the houses surrounding, or in those apartments. And so why would the vehicle come into play in that scenario? Okay, so there's that. But if we want to include the vehicle, then we could say that possibly it was someone, if it was still someone who was living in that same vicinity as the girls, maybe they used the car as a sort of cover, you know? Maybe they needed to get away quickly, and possibly, you know, they wanted to make sure that they could get away and clean themselves up, obviously, after they were done committing these murders, and be able to get away from the scene, as opposed to staying where they were having to go back to their house, which was within seconds or minutes of this crime scene, because they didn't know, you know, how long it was going to take to discover what it was they had done. And could have been minutes, it ended up being hours, but you can't tell that from that. So it's just a lot of theorizing at this point. It's a lot of we're just all, you know, throwing stuff up in the air and trying to get a sense for what it is that happened, because we don't know, and the police aren't telling us anything. The police are not telling the public much of anything. So this is all just from, like, people, you know, that come on here and look at all of these things. They go to the scene of the crime and they share it with other people, who then can put their eyes on it. And, you know, this is how things get solved these days. It's like a lot of cases get resolved in these ways because of people on YouTube who just become obsessed, you know. And it's like you want answers, you know. As a rule of thumb, as people, we're curious and we want to know what happened. So, all right, so we're going to talk about the front door thing. And so both of the girls came home before everyone else, the two at the bottom, and they had those keypad locks on their doors, it would make sense, because this is a party house. And so probably, you know, more often than not, the doors, the front door and the sliding glass door, you know, the points of entry, were probably left unlocked, or might have, you know, at the very least, forgotten a lot of the times to be locked. So it would make sense for, if you're a young girl, you come home, you live on the ground floor of a party house, what's the first thing you're going to do when you go in your room? You're going to lock your door, right? So it makes sense as to why they were left unharmed, because if they did walk in there and tried to enter the girls' bedrooms on the first floor and they were locked, then, you know, immediately, yeah, you're going to go upstairs and continue your murderous rampage from there. So it makes sense, and it's a work in theory. So let's
get it right. Is what all here. The neighbors told us. They had a lot of gatherings. This house and one other that I'll show you, had the reputation of being social butterflies. That's what they do, and we love those kind of kids. It's normal. However, if you're on the lower floor and you know that this is like, you know, traffic coming and going, and they're going up to visit, I would submit to you at some point those girls on the bottom are in a very high risk situation. So they're going to take measures of precaution on a nightly basis to lock those doors to their individual bedrooms, because not only do they have to worry about strangers coming in, it stuck right out to me when I saw it, and I thought, okay,
that were home were on the first floor, and one you have, yeah, I mean
when you were in
and so it is interesting that the two roommates that were home were on the first floor, and one you have to
I'm trying to
my initial thoughts on this out. You could see in pretty well. Again, it's hard to tell if maybe there's blinds in there inside and the authorities opened them up, or, you know, who knows, we don't know. And this steep slope of this whole area, and then how it's on a cul-de-sac, and so this isn't just like a house on a busy street. You have to know how to get there in order to get there. Does that make sense?
Yeah, everybody tracking us here for, you know, what the observation of this side of the house over here, that ladder's been there. You know, there's no scuff marks on the side of the house, it appeared. So, you know, if you're going to jump, use it. Now you can, right? You can surmise that somebody has the upper body strength to pull themselves up there, no problem. Then again, now they're exposed in the front of the house. So if anybody is, you know, pulling up.
So just want to reiterate, because I had a hard time understanding this. Like whenever I was getting this information strictly from the news, you know, it's kind of hard to picture, because we saw that view of the house a lot, you know, that side view. And so if you want to envision it better, like how I did, you know, it's this right here. So what you're seeing in that picture is there's the chain link fence that goes around this property here. There's a bunch of rocks in this yard. And so, you know, if you want to theorize that the killer entered in through this sliding glass door, which is like right on this side, you have like these two houses at the very least, and maybe even this one. You know, you're pretty open and exposed right here. Okay, so if you're entering from this side, you know, especially if the lights are on inside the house, which probably they were because of the partying nature of this house, you're gonna be very exposed. So unless you are like very comfortable and you feel like you're not gonna draw any attention to yourself, because you know, there's so much comings and goings, and you've probably been there many a times, I just don't see how somebody would feel safe entering in through that sliding glass door unless you're just have balls of steel. And so that is what makes me tend to think that it's possible that the he came from here in the tree line and snuck in through the back way somehow, or came up through here, that sidewalk path, and entered right in through the front door, because you're not as exposed on that side. So let me get into maybe, I think there was one more thing on this video.
At 3 o'clock in the morning, coming home from a, you know, a night out, boom,
so you
there's
see
a
that's
problem.
A chain link fence.
They could
see
be
how
seen. Now the lighting was to their advantage,
very
to the suspect's
close.
Advantage. But also now, so we come around this side of the house from the first floor there, you'll notice going on the second floor, there's starting to be a slope going up that embankment there. Okay? Add ice, add snow, okay? Or, you know,
and
weather
this window,
that
this
evening.
Was Zana
add the lights,
Ethan's
the hanging
bedroom.
Lights on the sliding, you know, by the slider there on the back patio, right? Now we have a lighting element, which is a disadvantage to the suspect, because the whole idea here is stealth with this individual. I think everybody can, we can probably all agree on that one. Now, is it probable or is it possible that the guy isn't thinking and he just wants to, you know, expose himself like that? It's possible, but not probable, because evident of the fact that he's not been captured yet.
Right. So that made a lot of sense to me, guys. What did y'all think about that video? I would definitely suggest, like I said, you go check out the rest of his video. He ends up going downtown to the bar where Maddie and Kaylee were out, and then the area where the food truck was. He does a lot more and just explaining. So I had to kind of shuffle through it really quickly because I wanted to get to other things. So very interesting content there. I recommend you check out his channel and this video if that's something you want to do. But let's get into other theories that we had, guys. And there was a lot, okay? There was talks of 4chan. There was, you know, talks of ex-boyfriends. I guess we'll start with this here. Okay, so around the time we looked at this video, my last video where I talked about these murders, the cops were on, were like, their body cam was provided to the public. And there was a lot of interesting things that people were noticing. And one of the most interesting things was they stopped these three guys for underage drinking. And they were right by the house. Like, I think this was, like, right by that grassy knoll. And in the background, going completely unnoticed by the police officers, but you could see them. You could see their silhouettes, was a group of guys that passed right behind them. And the cops didn't even look at them, didn't even stop them, didn't even talk to them. So let's watch that and then... We can do with that whatever it is we want to do with it. It's just an interesting thing, in my opinion. So, kind of got to look a little closely, but just look right here where this black circle is. And you'll see the people. Looks like 1, 2, 3, 4. Maybe 4 people, 4 guys, okay? They're going to zoom in a little more. So, I'm sure y'all can see that there. You know, who are those people that were passing by there? And it just goes to show you, this was at 3:15 in the morning, right? So the murders could have potentially either already started, or it could have been possible that they, you know, were on the brink of starting. And so it really is sad to see, because it's so disheartening how many people were actually there and walking around. It's a college area, you know, there's so many people, so many different factors, and so it puts a lot of pressure and a lot of work onto figuring who it is that did this, because, I mean, it could have been anybody at that point. There's multiple people outside walking around at the time of these murders. So I don't see, you know, if the killer was waiting for an opportune time, I don't understand how he found this to be the one, because it would appear to me that there was no opportune times. It was always going to be busy. It was always going to be people walking around doing things that they do in college. And so it just seemed like there was a moment and he took it. So I want to get into a couple of the theories now, guys. If you go on Twitter, because I could not navigate 4chan, right? So I went to the old reliable. There's a hashtag called Fratanon. And there's many interesting things on here. I don't want to go through all of it. But if you look up Fratanon, like just like QAnon, but Fratanon, there's some stuff to get into there. And a lot of people are throwing out a lot of things. I don't want to give too much credence to any one theory, but, you know... A lot of people are pointing to the frat guys, okay? So, if you guys don't remember, there was a period of time that the cops could not account for Ethan and Xana. So, it was said, and they were able to track Kaylee and Maddie's movements all throughout the night by, you know, providing or being able to provide surveillance footage from both the club and the food truck. But with Xana and Ethan, they were not able to do the same. And for whatever reason, which I pointed out last video, I don't understand why they couldn't use their cell phone triangulations and pinpoint them that way. But there was, you know, they that's not what they did. Apparently, they came out and said they didn't know exactly if they were confirmed to be at the party for the whole time that they were out. So... this is where the frat theory comes in, that some of these fraternity guys might be involved. That Ethan and a couple of the guys there at the party that night had gotten into it. And so you guys let me know what y'all think. If any of these theories are ringing true to you, let me know in the comments, and I would love to hear that. So, or if you have anything else that I haven't touched on in this video or will touch on, please let me know your thoughts, guys, because I would love to just consider everything. You know, there's nothing that's being ruled out yet, so we cannot rule anything out until the cops come out and say what it is they know about some of these people that people, you know, are just trying to find answers, and you cannot fault them for that. So this was one thing that was interesting. And they were talking about the 4chan post, which, like I said, it was hard to find. I couldn't, they kept deleting everything. So, it said, I saw the post and there was a lot of stuff true in that post, but I don't know who posted it. It's legit someone from school. There's no way a rando would know some of that stuff. Like being able to see the King Road house from David's apartment at Sigma. And, it says somebody else responded that I haven't talked to them again. The driver dropped them off and left immediately. They had nothing to do with it, and they didn't see anything weird. But I have been hearing about Ethan, having problems with some Sigma guys. Apparently, he had problems with a couple of them, too. Or M had had problems with a couple of them, too. E, M, and X were the targets. So he's referring to Ethan, Maddie, and Zaina. So they're also saying that Maddie might have had, you know, some sort of like relations or even just a friendship turned sour with some of these fraternity guys. And so in addition to that, they were acting very sketchy. You know, I don't know if you guys know anything about sorority and fraternity life, but I just know based on what I've seen with other crimes that were committed. And I'm not saying that they did anything. This is all apparent. This is all alleged. This is all my opinion. And do your own research. And these are just thoughts. These are not facts. Okay. So I just want to put that out there. But there's been other instances where fraternities have come under scrutiny because either one of their pledges dies, overdoses, whatever the case may be. Immediately, the people in that house go inward. Like, there's very little incentive to help police or to even help the parents of the person who might have been harmed in those houses. And it is because the reason why they join these organizations is because these are tools for them to gain reputation and to build stature and to kind of like build themselves up to be somebody of importance. Okay, so it's basically like you're everything is going to be on the line if something happens while you're a member of a fraternity that gets accused of something like this, like a murder, and it turns out to be true. I mean, these guys would just lose their entire livelihoods and probably would have many consequences too. I mean, these organizations are held to standards. You know, they're national organizations, so it's a lot of politics to go along with that. And I don't know the full ins and outs of that, but I have seen that personally with other crimes that were associated with other fraternity houses. So let's see. Let me get into, what's the next thing? Okay, so there was this other guy. There's been lots of different reporters that have come out and are reporting on all the stuff going on campus, and they're there, boots on the ground. So this one guy had a lot of interesting things to say. He's kind of all over the place, a little bit schizo energy, but that's all right. We like it. But these are just text messages that and Twitter threads from the guys at the fraternity house who were on here talking about, you know, just talking in very sketchy ways. Okay, so this was interesting here. This is from David, one of the guys at the frat house, saying that and no, we aren't making statements about it because we are trying to be respectful, but being accused of this broke me, and so I'm making this statement about myself specifically. So interesting wording there, David. Why just yourself specifically? Like, do you know something else maybe of someone else who might have been involved other than you? That is where you get me. Okay, so let's go a little bit further with this. And so, like, that's why I said, guys, look on Twitter. You know, if you know how to use 4chan, definitely check that out, because there was a lot of info, but just don't get lost in the rabbit hole, because it is deep, my friends. It is deep AF, okay? And, you know, like I said, this is all not proven to be any sort of fact. It is, at this point, just hearsay, and it is rumors with no regard. It is just something interesting to look at and to consider as we wait for more facts to come out about these murders, and we continue to pray that whoever did this will be caught. So yeah, he just goes on with that. But then I want to get into, there were some DMs. Okay, so he ended up DMing this guy. There's a lot of people responding on this Twitter thread, just very interesting stuff. But check this picture out that's coming. Okay, let me get to it right here. This right here. So explain this picture of your buddy, then. You probably helped him commit the murders. This is another thing that was going around, that it was possible that, you know, one of these frat guys felt scorned, and, you know, one or two of them decided that they were going to go over there, commit this murder, and that one acted as the sort of lookout, if you will. So that was another one that was just kind of like, you know, you can see it, but you don't know if you want to believe it, just because, you know, it is so crazy to think that these young, nice kids would do something like this. And it's, I guess it's not all so surprising. And obviously, look at the amount of blood. Like, I don't know what they're trying to say here. This man would have been covered in blood. And so, I don't even know where that picture's from, but it is just a little, you know, sussy, because obviously, what are you trying to prove with that photo? These people were stabbed to death. I mean, he wouldn't just have a little splotchy splotch of blood on him. You know, he would have been covered, drenched in blood. So, not really proving your point. So, okay, let me let him talk here.
You know, I actually, last month in November, the end of November, I actually reached out to David and had a conversation with him in Facebook Messenger, and he gave me a statement. He gave me a statement, and I want to share that conversation with you guys right here, right now. So this is a Facebook Messenger correspondence I had with David Barriochoa, which he is a member of the Sigma Chi fraternity that one of the victims, Ethan, went to. Back in November 27th, I sent him a message. Hi, David, we need to talk. Who murdered your fraternity brother, Ethan Chapin? He responds at 4 a.m. By the way, he responds at 4 a.m. I'm not sure what makes you believe I'd know. And I said, hi, David. I'm a journalist covering this case. Did you see Ethan that night? Y'all had a big party going on. He responds, no comment. David, who do you think did it? Please help me.
Weird.
And then I asked, was it Jake Schreiger? At the time, you know, Maddie's boyfriend. Some people were speculating him. He says, Gamma Eta chapter of Sigma Chi is grieving the loss of our beloved brother, Ethan Chapin, following the senseless tragedy that took his life over the weekend. We collectively extend our sincerest condolences and our most heartfelt thoughts and prayers to the families of our dear brother, Ethan, Zaina, Madison, and Kaylee. We also extended our most tender sympathies and fervent support to the women of the Alpha Phi and Pi Beta Phi who join us in grieving their loss. We respectfully ask for time and space so we can support each other in our healing process during this most unimaginable of times. So it's
so very interesting statement there, guys. Why even say anything? Why even respond to this boy if that's what you're gonna end up saying? You know, it just seems a little bit weird. It seems like you're kind of digging yourself into a hole here by even entertaining this, because if you don't have a statement, or if you don't have a comment, then why comment, you know? So it makes you wonder who wrote that. You know, obviously he did not write this big long paragraph. Who wrote that? Like, there's politics going on behind the scenes with this organization. And I'm not surprised by it, but that's just how these things go. So they don't want you to cooperate directly with the police. They want you to cooperate within the house. And they look after one another before, you know, immediately, you know, defaulting into helping police solve a murder. So he talked about, there was another David, right? So I want to get into this other YouTuber. We're going to switch gears yet again. And this guy was like, I don't know. If y'all thought this guy was a little squirrely, which he kind of is, but it's all right. Like, we like it. We like the weird personalities. We'd love to see these things, okay? But this guy was very odd. Okay, very much an oddball, but he had good content. So we'll give him his due. And so there's two Jacks, apparently. Jack DeCur, okay, was, I think, dealing with Kaylee at some point. And he lived in this house, apparently. This is all alleged still. I cannot prove this, but this is what I'm hearing. In this house here, which is literally, there's one house in between them and then his house. So he had access to this back, you know, forest area where if you want to say, if you want to accuse them of something, which I'm not doing here, I'm not accusing anybody of anything because I don't know. I'm just providing information that I got from the internet and that I thought was interesting, and I thought that it was relevant to what it is that people are talking about and trying to solve these murders. So just saying that this guy lived here, and then I want to get into, because he also touched on the other guy, the other Jack guy. And this was the guy that, if you heard early on in the investigation, people were saying had gone off to Africa, or, you know, the night of these murders. Apparently, he drove 6 hours to meet his family at their cabin. So, a lot of interesting things, guys. A lot of different options, a lot of different balls up in the air. And the police have already said they've cleared a lot of these guys, but people want to know why. People want to understand. And so I think right now everyone's just piecing things together as they can, you know? So let's get into a little bit of his video, and then I'll go to the other one where he talked about the other Jack and see if...
See, from the satellite view here, we've got what may be Jack's house on the left side, and over on the right side was Kaylee's house. There's only about 216 feet in between these two houses.
He looks like he's
wearing
makeup.
That's less than a football field away. And I've previously said that's about a 30-second walk.
That's how he wants to dress.
I now think that's about a 20-second walk. Anyways, let's take note of this house in the middle with the white roof. You can see it's surrounded by rocks and a chain-link fence in the background. And what do we see here? We see a picture of Jack and Kaylee. Some people have told me that Kaylee was way out of Jack's league. You leave me a comment and let me know down below. What do you think? Was Kaylee out of his league? Where do good guys actually win sometimes? Then again, in the end, she had broken up with him and was allegedly moving to Texas alone. So maybe nice guys really do finish last. Moving on, looking back at this satellite image from above, we can now see we have in our possession a picture of Jack, allegedly at the house on the left, as well as allegedly at the house in the middle with the rock yard. So one might think Jack could be very familiar with cutting through directly in between those two houses, or even secretly behind in the tree line where nobody would even see anybody creeping through. So let's take a closer look at this tree line and check out some images of behind the property. As you can see over to the left side, that's part of the tree line behind the property. And if you look off into the distance, you can see the house that Jack allegedly lived in, that Jack and Kaylee took that picture in front of. And I've previously showed...
And so this gives us a better view, guys. Like, this is literally coming out of that screen door. I mean, the sliding door. You can see how exposed this area is. I mean, any one of these, like, four houses I see right here in your view... can see this area, can see this patio area, and would be able to see, if you're looking, who is coming in and out of these sliding doors. So it's a very exposed area and very, you know, just sitting at the top of this hill, so you have almost like a vantage point. So it would make more sense if somebody was going to come that they would sneak from here or would sneak from the front, if that makes sense. You know, y'all let me know what y'all think about it. But I thought this was really great videos and photographs that he included. So that's why I wanted to give him his due and give him his credit on this information that I
showed you the TikTok video, as well as realtor photos inside that house showing that is the same house.
So yeah, this is from that house. Okay.
Have you ever tried those CBD?
Oh, Lord, here we go, ma'am. We don't want the CBD right now. We want to solve this murder. Thank you. No, thank you.
Closer, you can see the other house that Jack and Kaylee were photographed at with the rock yard. So you could either cut in between those two houses or through the tree line. It's a very short walk. We're going to take a quick look and look at a few more pictures from behind the victim's house to show you the tree line and give you an idea of what kind of tree line we're looking at. So what do you think about these photographs I've just presented?
Okay, guys. So I really like that information that he had there. So that's why I wanted to go and look at that, because it was an interesting, you know, and then the theory of... You know, Jack might have been upset because Kaylee was planning on moving to Texas after graduating, which was going to be a short period of time from that, you know, after that semester. So let's get into the other Jack, okay? Oh, here it is right here. Okay. No, wait, where is it? Okay, here it is. Okay, so Showalter, Jack Showalter. And I don't want, like I said, these are... not accusations against anybody. I'm just putting information out there. So let's see what he had to say about the other Jack. Just, you know, this was the one that apparently Madison was dealing with. That's why I wanted to include it, because these are just
relevant
information.
Let's zoom in on the eyes now. The eyes are clearly a match. This high-resolution show Walter in that footage. And even the police have only made the statement that they've cleared the male.
Okay, wait. Let me see. I'm gonna go back a little bit more. Oh no! It's gonna play another ad, isn't it? I will die. Oh no, I went to the next video. My goodness, YouTube. Just get it together. Okay, I'll go to about right here.
On my video on Jack D, the ex-boyfriend. That was my fastest growing video that I've ever released. It gained 50,000 views within the first 24 hours and over 2,000 comments. However, as a lot of you know, that video is no longer on YouTube. I'm going to discuss that later on in this video because I know you want answers. What happened to the Jack D video? We'll talk about it. But first, we're going to have a discussion on Jack Showalter,
so many Jacks,
aka who you think is the hoodie guy. There's been a lot of rumors about Jack, and I've been researching this guy for an entire month now. I'm not going to speculate or tell you that I know 100% sure about anything one way or the other. These are my opinions only, and nothing stated in this video should be taken as fact. Now for starters, Jack Showalter's name first popped up in this investigation on a website called 4chan. An anonymous person said, "Jack Showalter is the guy that did this." People decided that the food truck hoodie guy was Jack Showalter.
How can you just say that on 4chan, out your mouth?
That's never been 100% confirmed. The police have never said the hoodie guy is Jack. Jack has never said he was the hoodie guy. And nobody else has officially come out on the record and said that is 100%.
And we still don't know
Jack
who the hoodie guy is.
In that footage.
The police have cleared him, apparently, but we still don't know.
The police have made the statement that they've cleared the male in the grub truck video in the white hoodie. Well, this young man also has a jacket on. He's not only wearing a hoodie. Anyways, first things first, let's address, is Jack Showalter the hoodie guy? Let's look at some pictures here and compare. Now, as you can see, I've put both pictures on the screen. One of the hoodie guy and one of Jack Showalter. What do you think? Is this the same guy? On the left, you can see the shoulders slanting down a lot more than you see him on the right. But he might be wearing shoulder pads on the right.
I don't know.
Side.
I don't know how I feel about this. This is all speculation. This young man's
left.
Still alive.
The guy wearing the hoodie.
This
Let's
is all
this
alleged,
to the photo
guys.
On the right.
Okay.
They're both here. We just don't know 100% for sure. Kaylee and Maddie dipped out as soon as they could get their food. And the guy in the hoodie seemed very shocked at what happened. And as he walked off, right at the end of the footage, he walks off as well, and he raises his hand up towards them.
They know
However,
who that
his hand is.
Is
just out of frame. Some people think he's flipping them the bird. Some people think that he's waving to them. You can.
Okay, so he walks the other way. This is a new angle.
You see that in this clip right here. The reality is you can't tell what he's doing. You can't see his hand. Anyways, how about that big guy with the tan blazer on and the little tan hat? He said some mean things about the girls to the newspaper.
Oh.
What in the world is a 30-something-year-old man doing hanging around a bunch of college?
Yo, that was the guy. Okay, so I thought that was him. This is so interesting. Okay, it's like every day I learn something new about this case. It's insane. These YouTube sleuths are just like something else, you know? And I thought I got interested in things like this, and I thought I went into rabbit holes, but it's nothing compared to some of these other people. But so if you guys remember, we read an article that was very bizarre about this one guy who was like saying things to these girls and, like, you know, basically simping for hoodie guy and, you know, acting like he wanted to marry him or at least kiss him on the lips. And it was just a very odd article. And so did they ever clear this man, you know, this big man here in the tan? I don't know. They never said anything about that. So it looks, though, from that angle that the girls ran off and got in the car here, and then he briskly walked off into the other way. And so I don't know exactly the relation to the bar or where it was that he was walking, but even from this still shot right here, the police and anybody really who's familiar with the students and the people that live here could identify this young man. And so I don't understand why, what is the point of like keeping his identity under wraps if it's gonna come out anyways, and if they've cleared him, you know, what's all the hiding about? So okay, let's go
college
on.
Kids at the grub truck video in Moscow, Idaho. Further. You let me know down below. He seemed to have been acting a little odd that night as well. Let's
There's
talk about the rumors that he fled to his parents' cabin.
Okay, here we
Did
go.
Jack Showalter drive 6 hours on November 13th to go hang out at the family's cabin right after the victims passed away? Well, Jack Showalter's wealthy parents do seem to own a very expensive multi-million dollar cabin in Boise, Idaho. I've been researching this case for a month, and I can't find a single shred of any proof that Jack actually went to Boise that evening. If he did, that would be kind of alarming and would probably need to be investigated very deeply. However, on the internet, it just seems to be speculation and rumors. Jack hasn't said he went to his parents' cabin. His parents haven't said anything about it. The police haven't said anything about it. And nobody's gone officially on the record that knows him that said, yeah, he went to his parents' cabin that morning. So we're just guessing on the internet. Everybody on YouTube, Reddit, 4chan, various websites where you can discuss this case, it's all guesswork. Right. Nobody can tell you 100% for sure if Jack acted.
And that is so true. So there, he's going to get into some other things that I had already seen. And maybe you guys have seen about, you know,
the celebration of life.
There was, you know, pictures of him hunting with like different knives. And he had scanned some sort of animal while he was hunting. And so just kind of like irrelevant, you know, it's obviously it can look a certain way to people. And so that's why people are discussing it at this point. But I don't think it's very relevant because a lot of these guys do stuff like this. And so it's not that odd. But okay, so I guess this is Jack D. So I wanted to clarify that. So there's a Jack D and then a Jack S. So that's, I wanted to give you guys both. You know, I wanted to touch on both because people are talking about both of these guys. In addition to the frat guys, you know, everybody is up for grabs, it seems like, at this point, because we just want to know who and what it was that happened this night. So another aspect, guys, a last one that we will get into. And this one is, in my opinion, the most interesting, okay? So there was a guy, okay, if you don't remember from my last video that I did, I included, there was a news article or news segment where they interviewed one of the neighbors of the girls, and it was interesting because he said in the article that he heard a scream that night. And let me see if I actually have that video. I don't know if I do. Let me see. This might be the one where there was another neighbor interview that said that they had to put headphones in at night because they were unable to sleep with all of the party noises that were going on from these houses all the time. And so this was coming from, I believe, the neighbors that lived in the apartments right behind this house, or right to the side of this house, I guess I should say. So there was a lady who I actually ended up watching her videos from the first man that I showed you guys. He recommended the video of her, and so I'm very glad I did go and check it out. It was very eye-opening interview, and I'm gonna link that one as well, guys. You definitely need to go and watch the entire thing. It's like 40 something minutes long, and it was insane, y'all. This man that she interviewed, I'm gonna let you guys judge for yourself. We'll play a few minutes of it, and then that'll probably be it for this video. And I want to know your guys' thoughts on everything, because there was a whole lot, guys, a whole lot. And I mean, I really hope the police are zeroing in on something, because if not, this is only going to keep happening. People are only going to keep wondering and trying to figure out what it was that happened, because not only do they want to see justice, we all want to see justice for these young girls. I'm sure the people in that town don't want to be living amongst someone who could do something like this. I mean, I wouldn't. Would you? No. I mean, it's terrifying, the thought of it. So let's see what you guys think of this last guy, and we'll get, like I said, we're only gonna get into a few minutes. It's very, very fascinating, this interview, though, so I would recommend the whole thing, guys. Just go and watch it on your own time, because it's just too much for us to get into. So let's start it from about right here.
Those like two streets, right? Luxury.
Okay.
It's like parties, and like they're pretty full, and so like.
Let's see what she asked him first.
Heard in the news from.
Okay, here we go.
And I just want you to share with us what you know. Many also have heard of the neighbor that possibly heard a scream.
And she connected with him from Reddit.
Person. that I have with me now.
So she was able to locate him through Reddit.
Let everyone know this is going on.
Get this interview, which good on her.
As well, but right now I'm going to start with my questions because I have a lot of them. I want to thank you for being here. And first off, I think we should just start by taking us back to that night. The things I've heard in the news from you, Enon, are that it was an unexpectedly quiet night. You wrote about the crime on social media, and share what you remember from that night. Is that a good place for us to start right now?
Yeah. Okay. So, you know, I work about like 10, usually like 9 to 11 hour shifts. So I went to work, I got off around, I think it was around 12 that night. It was kind of like a late close, and I like bullshitted with like a coworker for a little while after work, and then I went home. You know, it was around, I don't know, like 1:30, 2-ish a.m. It's maybe when I got home, maybe. You know, I'm always like kind of hoping that I have like a parking spot right in front of my my door when I get there, because like lots of times on campus, you know, there's like parties and like they're pretty full. And so like this time I noticed that like, I don't know, it wasn't really any cars as usual. I was like, cool, I'm gonna get a nice spot right in front. And there was you know, like I saw like this sort of like kind of like decked out like luxury, like I thought it was black SUV, maybe like a Beamer or something, and it had like rims, tinted windows, and I was like, oh, that's like a pretty cool car. And then like, you know, coming out, like I noticed some like plates from like Arizona, I want to say.
So right off the bat, just want to say he's creepy. I mean, nothing against him, you know, especially if you are the killer, you know, sir. Please don't come for me, please. Stop right there. But I'm not saying that you are. I'm not saying that anyone is, because I don't know. I was not there. But the vibes that he's giving off is very much either socially awkward or creepy or both. And then his apartment, like what you can see behind him, is very odd, you know. And obviously this can be, you know, chalked up to just this is how guys decorate their house. You know, they'll put a mattress on the floor and hang up a wall clock all the way almost to the top of the ceiling, and they'll call it a day. But it's just very, very weird the way he started to then get into some of these things. The details that he was giving were very odd, guys. And so
and it was like,
let's get into a little
kind of a trip
more.
Having like the cops like come on and like, you know, when it happened, they're just like, you know, asking where we were. And we're like, this is weird. Like they're knocking on every single door in our apartment. Like that's never happened before. And then like I went inside and looked on the news and it was like four people stabbed to death. I was like, it's like right across the street. I was like, holy shit.
Yeah.
That was his reaction.
Wow. Yeah. When did you hear about it? Was it those knocks on the door? You woke up the next day? Did these knocks on your apartment door wake up?
Already,
how did you learn about it?
I was already awake. You know, I was just like woke up a little bit. I was still like drinking coffee, and like the cops knocked on my door, and like they asked me some questions, like right after they left, and started like they were starting to talk to the next door over. I looked on my phone and Googled it and found it pretty much instantly. And that's when I knew. And then I think it was like, I don't know, a couple days later when we like the names were released and we like found out who it was or whatever.
Okay, that was the question I was gonna ask. Like, did you
super brief, you know? But yeah, they were super nice and super friendly, like.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
They're like the best neighbors you could want.
I have a question here that you mentioned hearing a lot of sounds typically from the neighbors. Is this because it's highly populated, poorly insulated? Tell us a little bit about the neighborhood, because a lot of us, you know, all we see is only on the news. We're trying to grasp what this neighborhood is like.
So guys, I'm gonna go ahead and stop it there. I'll take that as a sign from God that was all we were meant to watch. But I'll leave it at that, a tease. It's such a good interview, guys. The vibes from that man, very, very odd. So he's a guy that is living in an off-campus apartment style you know, area where it's mainly college kids, and he spoke about his interactions with with all of these people. He said he had met Kaylee, had a few interactions with her. He spoke about how he had also met Xana and Ethan, you know, and he spoke about where he was at the time of the murders. Like, she asked him at one point, you know, like, when did he end up going to bed? And the answer he gave was, it was between 2:30 and 4, which was such a weird answer. Like, who gives that time range? When somebody asks you what time you go to bed, you give them an hour and a half time range. I mean, I don't. Like, I just thought that was very, a bizarre answer to give, because it seemingly covered the time of the murders, you know. So he was just in his little bed, fast asleep. For sure, he knows from 2:30 to 4. And the murders were perpetuated or committed from 3 to 4. So, very weird. Y'all let me know what you guys think down in the comments below. And definitely go watch that interview, guys. I'm going to put those links in the description box. And until then, guys, y'all stay safe. There is a lot going on in this world today, and we all need to be more diligent and look after one another, because it is scary to think that things like this can happen to people like this who are seemingly just nice, innocent, young people trying to live their lives. So let's keep them in our prayers, their families, the surviving roommates, and let's just try to be better to one another and stay safe. And until then, I will see you guys next time. And thank you guys so much. Please hit subscribe, guys, on your way out. I would so appreciate that. And I will see y'all on the flip side, okay? Bye, guys.